I am always, as always, clumsy, but I'm here. I presume you can hear me. If you, someone let me know in the chat that you can indeed hear what I'm saying. Good. Okay, we're going to start. Tonight we're going to do a meditation based on the ladder of Osiris, which is also Jacob's ladder, and this is a ladder that lives within us all. We're going to talk a bit first about the ladder and then ascend it. This ladder is first mentioned in the oldest religious text in the world, which is the pyramid text in the Pyramid of Unas in Egypt. It's from about 3000 BC. From time immemorial, human beings have longed to return to the stars. This is still very true. We'd love to go. It's why Elon Musk named his Mars rocket the Starship instead of the Mars ship. But there's another way to take this voyage, and we don't need a rocket. In the Bible, Jacob saw a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And at the top of the ladder, there is a column, and at the top of the column is God. For the Egyptians, this ladder was the Milky Way, ascending out of the Nile and reflected in it, as above, so below. This magnificent piece of poetry we'll read in a moment. But before, I would like to also mention that it was a worldwide phenomenon. It was not just the Egyptians who thought of this process of ascending into the stars on the road of the Milky Way, of returning to Orion. There's a magnificent piece of rock art in South Texas discovered by my old friend Jimmy Zintgraff on his ranch near the Pecos River 30 years or so ago, and it depicts the exact same journey. It's that universal. And the lower Pecos, when the night is clear on the lower Pecos, and it's not in the river's running, which is not always true, you can see the stars in the water just as you could in Egypt in the old days. See, the Egyptians could see them in the water. This poem I'm about to read is the first mention of the ladder in the world's spiritual literature. It comes from the pyramid text and is written on the wall of the pyramid. Make ascent possible by means of the light in accordance with Osiris. Tie the ladder by means of the falcon in accordance with his father, Osiris. As he moves into his light body, one of them is on one side and the other on that. Unas is between them. Unas is the soul who is being conducted through into ascension. Unas is between them. You are made into a star, a pure falcon among the constellations that rise purified. Taking his hand by means of the light, the light body goes to heaven as the Christ goes into the earth. Christ is the Egyptian word for corpse, which we eventually, it became the word Christ. And there's a very complex, there's nothing wrong with that. There's a very complex and deeply beautiful meaning to that that is present in the interior Christian literature as well. Now I'd like to just briefly mention the 21st card of the Tarot of Marseille. This is not true of other tarots. This particular tarot is it's the last hieroglyph really. It's the last statement of that ancient journey. I wrote a little book about it called The Path, which I think you can find probably on my website in the Whitley's Books section. It's as a Kindle. It's not available as a physical book now. It will be again, though. As soon as I finish writing the book I'm working on now, which is A New Vision of Jesus, I'm going to make it a point to get all of my old books back in publication. Anyway, in the 21st card of the Tarot of Marseille, which is called The World, there is a figure, an androgynous figure in the center, who is ascending. It is a man and a woman together as one person. And they have come into union with each other, and they are in a state of ascension. The four corners of the card have the four beasts of the Sphinx on them, the lion, the bull, the man, and the eagle, or in this case, we just talked about it as a falcon. Now, what does that mean? That means this, and this is so fundamental to all spiritual search, and to, in fact, the understanding of the universe, because Buckminster Fuller was right when he called the triad I'm about to describe the building block of the universe. The bull is strength. The lion is courage. The man is the intelligence to balance the two, the strength of the body and the courage of the emotions. And the falcon or eagle is that which spreads its wings and causes us to rise above life, to rise above life and to no longer be part of the hurly-burly of life. We instead begin to see it is exactly what Anne called it the day after she passed on. She said, Whitley, it's all a game. And once we see it that way, as a game, then we begin to rise above it. Now, what we're going to do tonight, though, has nothing to do really with seeing it as a game. I'm going to bring her into the picture here. She's right behind me. Seeing it as a game. What we're going to do instead is we're going to activate the energy of ascension that lies in the spine. And I'm going to explain exactly how the Egyptians thought of that. They thought when they said ladder, they meant the spine. The spine is, for them, the internal version of the way of ascent. Externally, it is the Milky Way. So to them, as above, so below, the spine was the body's vision of the Milky Way. A column of light, in other words. Surrounding the spine were seven little serpents encircling it called Taniter. Each one was called a Taniter, and I suppose the word Tantra came from that in later times. But these seven entities, these seven conditionals, I should say, were what drew experience from the body into the spine, where it was transferred into what we now call second body. And when the physical body died, it became the Christ, the mummy. And the second body ascended, carried by the falcon, if the second body wasn't too heavy. If it was, well, then that was basically that, I suppose. But that's not something we need to think about. We need not judge ourselves, and we need not judge the other man. We just have to do our best in our life. So what we're going to do now is we're going to move into a meditation on the spine and on what we now call the chakras, but which I still think of as the Taniter. And we are going to, go up the spine from chakra to chakra and ascend beyond that and below it, because we are transitional. We are between the earth and the sky, and our energy comes from drawing the bull of the earth to the courage of the sky, to the lion of the sky, with our intelligence, which enables us to turn into the falcon and ascend. Okay, so if you want to just relax and close your eyes, and we're going to do this together. Now, the first thing I want you to do, those who have you have meditated with me before know about this, and I'm not going to go through the whole sensing exercise because we're not doing that tonight. But what I want you to do is to move your attention, and you can do this. Your attention does not always belong to what's all around you. It belongs to you, and you can take it and you can move it to your body so that you're paying attention to sensation, to the way it feels to be in this body right now. Now, that seems like a small thing, and isn't consciousness connected to intelligence? No, consciousness is holistic. It's connected to the whole body. And the body, the second body, which is also right where the first body is and living within it, is our plug that plugs us into the consciousness of the whole universe. Now, come with me. We're going to go down to the base of the spine, where we find dawn. Deep red light just at the base of the spine. This is all of our earliest memories. It is also the light within us just being born. And we take our attention down to the base of the spine, all the way to the coccyx, and we place it there, and we bring into our imagination the beautiful red light of the very early dawn. Now we move up a little bit higher to the orange light of the middle dawn. The sun is rising, and our spine is beginning to fill with the light of the sun. And now we go up a little farther to the yellow light, to the light of midday, which is shining now down into our whole spine. The sun is giving us this light, so much light, that we can begin to look downward, and we are bearing on our bodies the wings of the falcon. We are forgetting the cares of the world, all of our identifications. Who will win the election? What do I believe? What do I not believe? This is all part of life, and it'll be gone in a minute. It'll be a memory in a minute. But we look down on the world, and it's transformed in this vision. It's beautiful and green, as it always was. And Osiris, in fact, his skin was the color green. And he became later on the green man of the European fairy faith. And when Mary Magdalene found Jesus in the garden, and she thought he was the gardener. So we look down at the world below us and our lives around us, which for each of us is the world below us. And now we rise a little farther into the purple light of the lower sky, into the blue light of the lower sky. And we shift our vision upward into this marvelous blue. When Annie died, I saw her rising into the bluest blue sky I have ever seen or hoped to see, the most beautiful blue. That blue is in every single one of us. It is in our souls, and it is part of the vibrant light that lives in us. And now we rise farther into what is called the light of the third eye. This is a purple light. It is actually the light as it appears at the edge of space. The light at the edge of space. And we take this light into us as we have taken all of the other light that we have found on our journey through the Tanetar. And now we rise up to the crown chakra, and the seventh Tanetar. And we see there violet light. It is the light of deep space. And you can see it if you look in the really, really high-res images of the Hubble in the Hubble telescope. You can see that violet in that light. And we take the violet and we find in it the stars, our star, and all of the other stars, the star we are following around the Milky Way galaxy on its grand journey, our little planet following it, and us too, each of us. That light becomes the light of the stars. It joins together. They join all of them together because they are one, just as us. We are one too. Remember, as above, so below. The white light of the stars now comes down into our spine and fills our spine. And we do what our Mother Earth created us to do over a long 5 billion year journey. She didn't create us to buy cars and watch TV. She created us to give her the light of the stars. And so we take this light and we extend it down into the center of the earth, where it becomes part of the body of the earth and our sensation with it that we set up at the very beginning. We extend the sensation of our body to include the body of the earth and the body of the stars as well. Our own body now is just a form, an outline in consciousness, slipping quickly, quietly through the universe on its eternal journey. Now, meditate with me a little bit, and let's together make the light within us bright and give it to our earth and give ourselves and our planet to the stars. So you can take this with you into your life. It's one of the oldest and most powerful meditations on the earth and very much wanted. You don't have to worry about protecting yourself from the disappointed realms when you do this. They can't see you. Okay, now we're going to open it up for questions, and we'll talk for a little while, until about 7:45. So if you have questions, and Donald Lord, I don't understand why it was holding your comments for review. They looked fine to me. So, okay. Oh, Tom Kalp, that's a long story. He asks if I found my driver's license. I was due to go to a conference in South Dakota 2 weeks ago and misplaced my driver's license, and my passport's expired, and so I couldn't go. And the answer is no. I've got a piece of paper that the DMV sent me. It's a piece of typed paper that says I still have a license, so I can drive. Of course, Word. If you've sent me an email about that, send me another, and I will definitely look for it. It suggests that I may not have seen it if you've already sent it. Joseph Anthony, thanks for that. It's a really powerful meditation, and if you do it often, you will find that it is useful in many ways that are really almost beyond words. Have I heard anything new from the visitors? Well, I live with them. So yes, I hear things new from them all the time. Meditation was designed mutually, in fact, last night, the night before last. Have the visitors ever shown me something you passed on like a pet? Well, they haven't shown me anything like that, but I have three pets in my life who have come back. One of them, my little dog, Candy, who was a little fox terrier who I had as a boy, came back. Oh gosh, 40 years ago, long before the communion experience. And what would happen would be, I'd be sleeping and lying in bed, and Candy used to sleep in bed with me, and I would stroke her fur often at night, and I would be sleeping and stroking Candy's fur, and she was just as real as that. And I would think, after a while, I would think, gosh, Candy, I wonder how you're getting pretty old, girl. And since she came into my life when I was 7, I was in my 40s, then I would think, well, wait a minute, she's a fox terrier. She can't be over 40 years old. And I would wake up and she would be gone. One night in 2008, Candy came and gave me a dream. And it was a very strange experience because I knew the dream was coming from Candy. And it was a dream of going down a road that was surrounded on both sides by heavy foliage and very narrow. And suddenly there was a car coming towards us at breakneck speed. And I realized it was night, that we would die if we ever found ourselves on that road. And then I had the Candy experience. And the next morning I told Anne about the dream and the Candy experience. And she immediately said, that dream is about the future. Candy gave it to you. And the next year we were at the Crop Circle Convention that's held in Devizes in England every summer. And one of the participants invited us to go down to Stonehenge, which is not far away. And on the way down, suddenly we both realized where we were. We were on that road. And the car showed up. We could see its lights in the distance. And Anne said, Whitley, this is the road. Turn around. And I turned around. I pulled over to the side and scrunched as far over to the side as I could. And the car passed us at absolutely breakneck speed. And I realized then, I was in this car in England. I was driving on the left. I was confused. I hadn't turned on the lights. But we lived because of one of our pets. The other two also came back, Co and Sadie, the cats that my son grew up with and that were our pets when we were. So I'm very, very devoted to them. Dog is my spirit animal, in fact. Oh, just finished A New World minutes ago, Ken. Gosh, it's been too long, my dear friend. Ken Ring is a very, look up Ken Ring on Amazon and buy his books. He's a wonderful writer and a man who has done a great deal for the people of this world on many levels. How do I bring benevolent beings to myself? I want to learn to know. Well, one way, here's the best way. You live out of love, compassion, and humility. Those are the three pillars of a strong soul. And if you really work at understanding what those are and for you and living them, you will bring benevolent entities into your life in droves. And doing something like this meditation is helpful too, because it's the meditation of a good human being, and it shines out very brightly. You will be seen if you do it. So that would be a good way. Well, Egyptian gods weren't actually gods. The question here is there a relationship between communicating with Egyptian gods and communicating with aliens, for instance? This is such a complex question. The Egyptians personified natural forces and into gods, and they were very well aware of what they were doing. They were very sophisticated people in terms of the soul and the spirit, very sophisticated. Now, when the fairy faith comes along many thousands of years later, suddenly those are the visitors. They are the fairy folk. And and that relationship with them, our relationship with them, really begins then in about the 16th century and is now obviously exploding into something that's a general reality among mankind. But I don't think the Egyptian gods were aliens. I think that the visitors, maybe we were, I don't want to say that we were interfered with genetically, because I think that this solar system was designed from the beginning as a life-bringing machine. It is designed to draw life out of planet Earth and to protect that life. So what is the best way to send healing energy to a friend who has a serious illness? Yeah, you can do what you can visualizing, Melanie, and I hope it helps. It does sometimes, and we don't know why it does or why it doesn't, but just give it all of the love you can. That's, and hope for the best. So let's see here. Ask to make peaceful contact, meaning from the bottom of the heart, faith over fear. Ha ha, that's so true. I have, look, the grays are real and they're tough cookies. We might as well just get used to it, because that is the case. You know, and what they are, though, I don't know. But when you think about this solar system, What you have here is this. You have a yellow dwarf star that is strangely quiescent compared to the other yellow dwarfs we see in this universe. It does not periodically have flares that would sterilize the whole solar system. Most of them do. Not only that, our planet is just the right distance away and just the right composition from the star and just the right composition to maintain life. And it's a sort of ongoing miracle too, because, you know, we think of the oceans as being so deep, but they are actually extremely shallow in comparison to the actual depth of the planet. They're just like a film of water on the surface of the planet. And we don't actually know why it hasn't evaporated millions of years ago. It should have, but it doesn't. Now, so there's that. And then there is the moon, which is in just the right place and moving in just the right way to slow down our orbital winds so that the rotation of the Earth doesn't generate a wind so strong that no higher life forms could ever form here. It's amazing when you think of it. And then to make, and of course the moon also absorbs a lot of punishment from meteors and asteroids and so forth, as you can see. Now, there's another planet, the gas giants out beyond Mars, absorb even more punishment. So we rarely get hit by an asteroid. I'm not saying it doesn't happen, because it does. It does, and it can. But when you look at all of this together, you think to yourself, did somebody build this thing? And then I can't forget that one of the grays once communicated to me, I created you. And I don't know exactly what it means. When they say something, it always means everything it can. They're very economical. So I guess it means that she created me and in a sense maybe was responsible for the genes that went into me in my birth and shepherded me through life and helped me write communion by scaring the dickens out of me. And maybe she also meant she created the whole species, or they created us. I don't know, but I do know this. I am very thankful and grateful to whoever created us. I like to think of it as that what Anne so beautifully described after she died as the yearning that underlies gravity. She said, that's God. There's a yearning there. You think about God in terms of that yearning, and you think of that all of creation comes out of it, and you fall in love with God in a whole new way. Joseph Anthony says, I believe we have been genetically modified. It's hard to believe we haven't been. I think that maybe millions of years or billions of years ago, someone created this planet. But I think others have come, or maybe the same ones have come from time to time and meddled about in the genetics of the planet. And, you know, if you look at some of the ancient creatures, you think to yourself, were any of the aliens who came here practical jokers? Because, I mean, look at these things. They're so ridiculous. It's hard to believe that anyone would have created them except for a joke. Any book recommendations on the topic of Egyptian religion history? Oh, there are so many. Wallace Budge wrote some beautiful books. Dr. Shuala de Lubitsch wrote some very mystical books. Most recently, I think the best book is The Dawning Moon of the Mind by Susan Brind Morrow. You can get it on Kindle, and it is a beautiful book. The poem of Osiris that I spoke is a version of the one that is in the book, although I like to work with the hieroglyphics myself, so it's a little different from hers. But so Have I seen the physical visitors in their physical form recently? Yeah, about 6 weeks ago, for a few seconds, I whined and whined to get one of the grays to actually show up because it had been so long. And I got a 5-second meeting. I was looking for like a month, that why don't we just live together for a month? And then I said, well, what about a week? Then I said, well, what about an hour? I got 5 seconds, so I'm happy. They really are not interested in coming out until it's their time, their right moment. The reason is they're incredibly sensitive to cultural colonization. They know that as soon as we realize as a culture that they're real, we are all going to turn toward them and forget about our own journey. And they don't want that. They're interested in us for our journey. Do ritual magicians have a different or stronger connection to the visitors? Have they always? Well, I do know a fair amount about ritual magic. And if anyone is interested in that, be very aware that there is a world that it affects, and do not play with black magic at all. And I was dealing with a man who was into black magic recently, and Anne gave me the information that it tattoos your soul. And exactly, Joseph. It's a door you can't close. So if you want to explore magic, the magic of your own heart. And the visitors might tempt you toward black magic because they are always looking for weaknesses. Don't go down that road. Black magic is like candy. It's sweet at first, then you get sick of it. Thank you, Red Sun. Very well put. And exactly, black magic is an attempt to change another person's free will, and it is wrong. Charles Johnson, I consider Egyptian gods to be an underworld inner experience. Given your works, I expect you to affirm the visitors as an underworld experience. Is that so? They are both, interestingly enough. I would have thought that they were an entirely underworld experience. And what Charles means by underworld, I assume that you, Charles, that you know a fair amount about Egyptian religion and mythology. It's not quite the same as what we think of, but we can leave that go for the moment. I did not realize that they could manifest physically. And this has been actually the whole theme of my life, has been the ways in which this non-physical underworld realm can actually move into the physical world. And that's what my whole narrative, if you read all the communion books, the narrative is about that, essentially. And that, I think, is something new that is happening to all of us. So Ward says, the aliens led me to magic, but nothing negative. Well, you know, I've had some weird things happen recently in my life. My apartment became filled with black widows. And when I was away week before last, someone came in and jimmied the door of the microwave oven and ruined it. And what was strange about that was the surveillance system was on, but the surveillance system turned itself off on the Saturday night. It didn't send an alert that it was off or anything. And when you look at the recordings, the videos, it just stops. It doesn't say camera is off or anything, which it should have said. And then it starts again the next morning. And then during that time, whoever came in here and broke that did it. And then a few days later, someone attempted to drop a hot check for $5,000 on my bank account. And so I thought to myself, maybe I need some good magic here. And I have a dear friend who's in fact going to be the guest on Dreamland this weekend, an astrologer called Tashi Powers, who will be as well in the subscriber video chat with us on Saturday morning. And she proceeded to give me a whole outline, a whole array of gems to use in the context of my chart. And on Saturday morning, she'll explain all of that and what it means. But it was positive magic. And I think it's helpful. I didn't actually skip over the heart chakra. I used it differently, Joseph. He says you skipped over the heart, central or heart chakra, which brings a beautiful emerald green light. It balances us and connects us to all other beings. That is so true, and that's a beautiful way of putting it. But what I was doing was using this as a tool of ascension, slightly differently from the chakra exercises or the chakra meditations that you're probably aware of, which are incidentally also extremely powerful and beautiful. But you're quite right. That's exactly right. I did that very intentionally. Okay, we have come to, you're just about, I have another couple of, here, Joel August, visitors seem initiators, enlightening and terrifying. Oh, yes. Yes, they are definitely both. I have been through the ringer with them, boy, I'm telling you. What are some moments when you felt loved by the visitors? Well, Dylan asks. Well, I all the time now. All the time. I feel cherished, and I feel cherishing. Punger, that's scary about your apartment. Your neighbors saw nothing. Well, we don't have an outdoor camera. There's no lobby here, and there's extensive surveillance here. I'm not going to go into exactly how it works, but it's very sophisticated and very in-depth, and it did not function. It was turned off by someone with unusual electronic skills. Let me put it that way. Ward Alien Video, negative thoughts almost never enter into my psyche. Well, I wonder, Ward, if you drive in the city of Los Angeles at all. Because if you don't, you might try coming here when the pandemic's over and driving around for a while with us other morons and seeing if you can keep the negative thoughts out of your head. Because in L.A., when we get into cars, our IQs drop to 40. All of us. We're all the same. Except me. I become a genius, but they're all morons. And I have F-bomb torrents when I drive. Oh, yes, exactly. I always remember that Whitley is just me. I'm not some guru when I'm sitting behind the wheel of a car. And thank God for it. Because we all need to remember what Annie used to say in this life, when she was in this life. There are no teachers here. Only students, and whoever calls himself a master is not that. Have you thought about coming back to Dallas? That's where I'm living. Well, I never lived in Dallas, Dylan. I lived in San Antonio and Austin. I like Dallas. I'm a Texan to my core. I love Texas. I love the things about Texas. Wonderful stories about Texas, so many of them. Well, you know, there's one thing about Texans. You can tell a Texan, but you can't tell him much. And that's the way we are. So Don't live in Dallas, higher crime. Well, I live in Santa Monica, and crime is getting out of control here. We had just today, there was a guy that was inexplicably taped to a billboard on Cahuenga Boulevard with duct tape, and someone attacked somebody with a syringe in a parking lot on Santa Monica Boulevard around the corner from here a few hours ago. So it's pretty crazy. How did I lose my Texas accent? C. Isabel asks. Well, I never had one, actually. My great-grandmother was English, and she lived to 106, and so she was very much part of the family. And her daughter, my grandmother, didn't have a Texas accent. And my mother didn't either. I just didn't develop much of one. When I was a real little boy, I had one. When I was 10 and 11, I had one, but then it just sort of went away. Claire Guest, pervasive fear makes people act crazy. Boy, that is so, so true. And we are going crazy. The visitors told me early on in this that you will go insane. And it is so true. We are really going around the bend about this COVID thing. And it's inevitable that we would. It's terrifying. And we don't know what to do about it. And we're all mixed up ideologically in that, in the sense that we've got our country's divided into two ideological camps. One is individual liberty and freedom of expression and laissez-faire economics. The other is community participation, group connection, and also a form of group economics. That's the Democrats and the Republicans. And the problem is we can't change horses. We're too set in our ways. And when this started, we needed the group and the community, but the Republican president continued with his ideology. The same thing happened in 1929, 1930, when Herbert Hoover was in power and the banks began to collapse. He sat on his hands. And it's not that he was wrong. It's because of the way our minds work, the way we are as people, as beings. And this has happened again. And, you know, we can't turn around and do it another way. We stick to our guns. So, unfortunately, and we have this complicated situation now that we're dealing with. Yeah, we can only change ourselves and listen to others, Claire Guest says. That's so true. And changing yourself is really a big project as well. You have to really look into yourself. And that kind of in looking. The book I'm writing about Jesus and the Jesus teaching is about how that kind of real looking into yourself is at the core of Jesus's message. Anne was very involved in Jesus studies. And since we're still together and she's got a hell of a lot of information, I'm having a lot of fun with this book. Let me put it that way. Oh, COVID is not a hoax. You're in dreamland. I mean, I have a show called Dreamland, and we don't promote that on the show because it's false. And there's nothing you can do about it. It's real. It's not a giant hoax. It's very real. And if it was a giant hoax, then I have friends who've died of a hoax, and I don't think so. They didn't die of a hoax. They suffocated, two of them, in hospitals in Texas. And it was a hard death. One of them was asleep in a respirator. The other one was, yeah, exactly, Red Sun. COVID is a hoax until your lungs are destroyed. Went to the ER when he stopped being able to breathe, and he died in the ER struggling for breath. And if that's a hoax, then it's quite a hoax. Well, let's try to remember the wings of the eagle or the falcon and rise above all of this in this world. The hoaxes, the truths, the conspiracies, all of this. Because unfortunately, there are in our world now thousands of bizarre and fallacious conspiracies, but they're there because there are real conspiracies. They poison the well with their lies about things like Kennedy and UFOs and things like that. And now they say, oh my God, there's all this, all these crazy conspiracy theories around. And I say this to the people in the intelligence community that I know, this is your bed. Lie in it because you created it. All right. We haven't learned much in 100 years. If you read history, I would say it's more like we haven't learned much in 5,000 years. Okay, we're going to sit together for just a couple of seconds and reconnect with each other. So stop the chatting. You can chat again after I'm gone. It'll still be open. We come together now. There's only one human being here in this world. It's just really complicated. If you think of it that way, it becomes an awful lot of fun to be yourself. Incidentally, we have chats every Wednesday night on our website in the subscriber chat room. And there's a free forum you can join if you wish. It's a very social website, unknowncountry.com. And if you would like to subscribe to it and help us keep going, that would be nice. Thank you very much for being with me tonight.